Why should we give land to the Indians when it clearly says on the paper it belonged to the farmers?
But surely you must realize that this is their home. These indigenous tribes have been living on this land for hundreds of years.
Listen, this world is not fair. Some people win, some people lose. The whole world think they can tell Brazil what to do with her land. Sorry, no. We do what we please.
Unsere Erde. Stets ist sie im Fluss und in Bewegung. Eine dynamische Symphonie von Kräften, die alle zusammenwirken und Leben in die vier Himmelsrichtungen atmen. Und seit Tausenden von Jahren nennen Kulturen auf der ganzen Welt sie ihre Mutter.
Incredibly beautiful planet. A home that we will hopefully pass on to generations to come. But as years go by, it's becoming increasingly hard to imagine what kind of a world we're leaving behind us. We've spent the last 4 years traveling around the world, filming the stark reality that people now face from the threat of ecological collapse. It's now become very clear to us that there's one thing driving the destruction of our ecosystems faster than anything else. Let us show you how this very same thing might just also be our salvation.
And environmental scientists warn that we are fast approaching the point of no return if we don't make a substantial course reversal.
We see really serious catastrophic effects in the next few years, certainly in the next decade or two. The world will be completely different from the way it is now.
Seit 1900 sehen wir einen dramatischen Anstieg an weltweiten wetterbedingten Katastrophen. In den letzten 50 Jahren gab es viermal mehr wetterbedingte Katastrophen als in der vorherigen 100.
We began to work together to move this issue onto the global center stage. There was a lot of discussion about the contribution from buildings and from industrial factories, but I became aware during that same period of time that there was another factor that was going undiscussed. And that is the role of animal agriculture, which I could see was playing some significant role around the planet. But this was the elephant in the room no one wanted to talk about.
Whatever environmental issue you want to look at, from species loss to water pollution to water use to climate change, animal agriculture is one of the top causes.
The critical, widespread negative impact of animal agriculture on our planet is undeniable. Severe global crises, from climate change and environmental damage to species extinction, hunger, poverty, disease, and antibiotic resistance, all of these have direct connections to animal agriculture and the massive inefficiency of our current food production systems.
Schon 2009 veröffentlichte WikiLeaks einen Bericht, wurden Gespräche, genannte Tour de Horizon, zwischen Nestlé-Managern und US-Beamten offengelegt wurden. Laut Nestlé prognostizierten ihre eigenen Studien, dass der Welt innerhalb der nächsten 30 Jahre das Frischwasser ausgehen werde. Als eine der Hauptursachen für unseren Irrweg auf diesem Katastrophenpfad nannten sie den weltweiten Bedarf an Fleischprodukten.
If you look at the impact that food choice has on global warming, it's very significant. Eating meat is huge for global climate. And that's something where personal choice is the determining factor. So there's the only case I can think of where individual human choice would have a big effect would be food.
We're now over the line. And the idea that we're going to double meat production between now and 2050, this is just unsustainable. This is going to have to give. Our diet is taking us to an abyss.
A significant reason why livestock production has been having such a huge impact on greenhouse gas emissions is because of the large surfaces of forests that have been destroyed in order to make room for pastures and for the growth of soybean and maize for feedstock production.
Unsere Wälder waren einst voller unglaublicher Lebensformen. In den letzten Jahren wuchs unser Appetit auf Fleisch- und Milchprodukte auf rasante Weise. Mit diesem Wachstum stieg auch der Bedarf an Landflächen. Also hackten und brannten wir uns durch unberührte Wälder, vernichteten alles auf unserem Weg, um Platz zu machen für die Tiere, die wir essen wollten. Da diese Tiere nicht frei umherziehen durften, wie sie es in der Wildnis tun, wurden ihre Weideflächen bald leer. Und so mussten wir sie natürlich füttern. Und wieder hackten und brannten wir unsere Lösung durch immer mehr Wälder, säten genetisch veränderten Mais und Soja und badeten diese dann in Pestiziden, Herbiziden und synthetischem Kunstdünger. Die Tierhaltung hat sprichwörtlich das Angesicht unserer Welt verändert. Riesige grüne Landflächen, die den Globus umspannen, werden für Menschennahrung genutzt. Landflächen, die wir für die Tierproduktion benötigen, hier in Rot, nehmen mittlerweile riesige Areale auf der gesamten Welt ein. Und sie sind größer als die, die wir für Menschennahrung benötigen.
Almost all the Earth's surface is now bears the mark of some kind of human impact. And most of that is livestock production.
Agriculture has transformed the planet like nothing else. To produce milk, we farm an area about the size of Brazil. To produce beef, we farm an area about the size of Canada, the United States, the whole of Central America, Venezuela, Colombia, and Ecuador combined. To produce eggs, we farm an area the size of Sweden. To produce aquaculture feed, an area about the size of the UK. A plant-based diet would reduce the amount of land required to produce our food by 3.1 billion hectares. That's an area the size of the entire African continent.
Der Amazonas ist der größte tropische Regenwald der Welt. Diese alte und reichhaltige biodiverse Welt wird allmählich ersetzt. Es wird oft angenommen, dass viel von dem Soja, das in Brasilien angebaut wird, menschlichem Verbrauch dient. Tatsächlich sind weniger als 6% des Sojas, das weltweit angebaut wird, für Menschen bestimmt. Der überwiegende Teil wird angebaut, um Tierfutter zu erzeugen. Das Soja wird in die ganze Welt exportiert und an die Milliarden Hühner, Zuchtfische, Schweine und Kühe verfüttert, die wir täglich essen. Die Wälder sind nicht nur Heim für Millionen Spezien von Wildtieren und Pflanzen, sondern sind auch großartige Regulatoren unserer Erdatmosphäre. Tag für Tag atmen die Wälder langsam Kohlendioxide ein, während sie Milliarden Tonnen frischen Sauerstoff produzieren. Jedes Jahr gehen geschätzte 18 Millionen Hektar am Wald verloren, etwa die Größe von Panama. Es wird angenommen, dass die Hälfte der ausgewachsenen Tropenwälder nun zerstört sind. Und manche Wissenschaftler sagen voraus, dass wenn wir so weiter wirtschaften, im Jahr 2030 nur noch 10% dieser Wälder existieren werden.
One of the most precious things we have in the world is our rainforests. The rainforests are literally being chewed away by farmers who know they can make money by cutting another acre and then another acre and then another acre for meat.
Nosso avô, naquele tempo, cacique, então já falou, olha, você vai sofrer muito, porque o branco ruralismo.
Sie werden gewaltsam von ihrem Land entfernt. Viele werden von den Paramilitärs der Agrarkonzerne ermordet, die ihre Dschungelheimat im Farmland verwandeln und Soja für Tierfutter anbauen wollen. Jedes Jahr werden Dörfer von hunderten Ureinwohnern des Amazonas komplett niedergebrannt.
Para nós indígenas, antigamente as florestas que é a nossa casa. Quem começou a destruir a nossa aldeia é através da agropecuária.
Então derrubaram as nossas matas, destruíram os animais, os rios.
Eu tô falando, agora vai plantar soja, aí depois vai passar veneno, né? Tudo coisa. Vai passar adubo também, vai cair tudo no rio. E nós revoltando no Sotecorrá, pra... para sustentar a nossa família.
So there was actually a report that came out in 2018, and they found that the world's top five livestock corporations now release more annual greenhouse gas emissions than ExxonMobil, Shell, and BP. It is crazy when you think about it, because the EU is spending £24 billion of taxpayers' money on livestock farming each year. And this is at a time when we are facing an ecological collapse and we drastically need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So it's no surprise that people are asking a lot of questions now about the fact that there seem to be some serious conflicts of interest going on here.
There's some very heavy lobbying going on of government, and I think that happens throughout the world. And it's just a historic thing that needs to be, I think, rebalanced.
As I've mentioned to you over the phone, I've worked with a number of large livestock companies around the world. So the way it works is that a representative from pays us usually up to €500,000. We then target the relevant politicians from different governments around the world, and motions are made to pass legislation in favor of the company's business strategies. For environmental policy, we can be very persuasive in order to abolish or heavily relax environmental regulations in government, so our clients have more freedom in their work. The other day we managed to kill proposed legislation that would have had a huge impact on the industry based on a report from the UNFAO. You know, the industry is just concerned with growth, but the environmental data that's coming out now, it's really making that difficult for them.
Today, democracy does not always function as well as it should because of the huge influence that agribusiness corporations and livestock producers in particular exercise on decision making.
A former director of the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization, Dr. Samuel Jutsi, warned as far back as 2010 that interventions by agribusiness lobbyists were blocking reforms that would offer better standards for human health and preserving the environment. Big animal agribusiness corporations and food producers' influence over political decisions about the regulation of their industry has long been a concern for campaigners who see the narrow interests of the industry taking widespread control.
If we have any doubt about how powerful this influence is, we can recall that, for example, when the Advisory Committee on Dietary Guidelines in the US made recommendations to the US government as to how dietary guidelines should be shaped, they were blocked by this very powerful lobby of agribusiness interests.
2013 veröffentlichte die Ernährungs- und Landwirtschaftsorganisation der UNO, die FAO, einen richtungsweisenden Bericht unter dem Titel Klimawandel durch Viehhaltung meistern. Der Bericht besagt, dass Viehhaltung für mehr Treibhausgasemissionen verantwortlich ist als das gesamte globale Transportwesen. Eine wachsende Zahl von Wissenschaftlern glaubt, dass der Einfluss der Tierzucht sogar schlimmer ist, als im FAO-Bericht dargestellt wird.
There are close ties between the research organizations and governments and government policy and industry. It's very pervasive because livestock industries depend on government policies that support them.
The FAO report was prepared within the FAO by specialists of agriculture and livestock production, not by specialists of the environmental issues associated with agricultural production. I believe that a more serious concern, of course, is that the International Meat Association was involved in preparing the report, which does raise the question of the independence with which the study was prepared.
Government policy in that regard is not for the benefit of the land, it's for the benefit of the industry.
In ihrem Bericht arbeitete der FAO mit Mitgliedstaaten, Nichtregierungsorganisationen und vielen anderen Verbänden zusammen. Auch der Europäischen Feed Manufacturers Federation, der International Dairy Federation, dem International Meat Secretariat, der International Egg Commission und der International Poultry Council. In einer Industrie mit einem Wert von über einer Billion Dollar sind das nicht genau die Institutionen, die am meisten zu verlieren haben durch eine Forschungsstudie gegen Viehhaltung? Es gibt wenige, die mehr über das Meer wissen als Dr. Sylvia Earle. Dr. Earle war die erste Frau, die leitende Wissenschaftlerin der United States National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration wurde und hielt den Rekord für das freie Laufen auf dem Meeresboden.
When I was a child, the idea of a dead zone in the ocean was not even in our vocabulary. But in the 20th century, as agriculture began to greatly expand, the areas around the coast began to show signs of wear and tear. The first most notorious spotlight area, I think, was off the Gulf of Mexico. And it has simply grown over the years, an annual phenomenon. It is coincident with the application of massive amounts of fertilizer.
Die Millionen von Quadratkilometern, die wir dem Anbau von Nutztierfutter opfern, werden intensiv mit Stickstoffdünger besprüht. Der Stickstoff läuft von den Feldern in die Flüsse und am Ende in unsere Meere. Das stickstoffreiche Wasser stimuliert massiven Algenwuchs. Die daraus resultierende Algenblüte ist aus dem Weltall erkennbar. Die Algen nehmen dem Wasser den Sauerstoff und führen zum Absterben des umliegenden ozeanischen Lebens. Seitdem der Bedarf nach Fleisch steigt, weiten sich diese sauerstoffarmen Zonen immer weiter aus.
Hundreds of dead zones that have developed all around the coastlines of the world. And Okay, people say, that's too bad for the fish. So sorry, fish. But we need to understand that what we do to the ocean, we're doing to ourselves. I want others to see and to see for themselves. This is all we've got, this little blue miracle.
Manche glauben, dass der Wechsel von Fleisch zu Fisch einen positiven Effekt für den Planeten hätte. Nichts könnte weiter von der Wahrheit entfernt sein. Wenn das Meer stirbt, werden wir Menschen wohl mitsterben, da jeder zweite Atemzug, den wir nehmen, durch unsere Meere erzeugt wurde. Die führende Wissenschaftszeitschrift Nature berichtet, dass wir fast 90% aller großen Fische seit den 50er Jahren verloren haben. Eine der detailliertesten Studien aller Zeiten, die Fischbestände untersucht hat, ebenso im Journal Nature veröffentlicht, stellte fest, dass bei der heutigen Fangrate die Fischereien weltweit in weniger als 30 Jahren zusammenbrechen werden. Laut IPBES, einer zwischenstaatlichen Institution, die den Zustand unserer Biodiversität ermittelt, ist Fischerei der Hauptgrund für das Aussterben der Meere. Unser Appetit auf Fisch entzieht den Meeren sprichwörtlich das Leben.
Today we have agreed on fishing opportunities for European fishermen worth more than 5 billion euros and benefiting more than 50,000 fishermen. The catches agreed today will continue to make the European fishing industry highly profitable also in 2019.
Schönes Land mit atemberaubenden Landschaften. Es ist aber auch ein Ort, der düstere Geheimnisse birgt. Norwegen ist einer der weltweit größten Zuchtfischexporteure, eine Industrie, die für das Land Milliarden Euro wert ist. Da viele der wilden Großfischpopulationen am Rand des Aussterbens stehen, wenden sich die Fischer der Aquakultur zu, um Fische in kontrollierter Umgebung zu züchten. Norwegen produziert mehr Zuchtlachs und Kabeljau als jedes andere Land der Welt. Etwa 70% des heute verzehrten Fisches stammt mittlerweile aus künstlichen Fischzuchten. Tausende Fische werden in Käfigen auf engstem Raum gehalten, was zur Verbreitung von Krankheiten und Läusen führt, die ein massives Problem für die Fischindustrie darstellen. Daraus resultiert der weit verbreitete Einsatz von Pestiziden, Desinfektionsmitteln und Antibiotika, um die Fische bis zum Verkauf am Leben zu erhalten. Um die Fische von Läusen zu befreien, werden spezielle Pumpboote benutzt, die die Fische in einem gigantischen Wassersauger hineinziehen. Die Fische werden dann durch ein System gepumpt, in dem sie auf hoher Temperatur erhitzt oder in einer chemischen Lösung gebadet werden, um die Läuse zu entfernen. Dann werden sie in ihre Käfige zurückgepumpt. Die Fische werden in Chemikalien wie Wasserstoffperoxid gebadet, aber auch in Acemetiphos, um Parasiten abzutöten. Fischfutter enthält Chemikalien wie Teflubenzuron, Emamectrin und Diflubenzuron, die per se giftig sind. Forscher sind der Ansicht, dass Chemikalienreste im Fisch letztendlich auf unserem Teller landen können. Dies gilt so ziemlich für jeden Zuchtfisch weltweit. Taryn Bishop, Umweltaktivistin, trifft sich mit den Green Warriors, einer Umweltschutzorganisation aus Bergen an der Westküste Norwegens. Die Green Warriors haben die zerstörerischen Praktiken der Fischzuchten auf das lokale Ökosystem viele Jahre untersucht und zeigen Taryn die dunkle Seite der Zuchtanlagen. Mit Hilfe eines speziellen Tauchgerätes können sie den Meeresboden unter den Käfigen sehen. Auf dem Meeresboden unter den Käfigen liegt eine dicke Schicht Schlamm aus Fischabfällen, Bakterien und nicht gefressenem Futter. Der Schlamm ist voll von Pestiziden aus dem Futter. Neue Forschungsergebnisse zeigen, dass die riesigen Mengen an Pestiziden, die weltweit durch Fischzuchtanlagen in das marine Ökosystem gelangen, katastrophale Auswirkungen auf die Biodiversität der Meere hat. Der Schlamm gibt außerdem große Mengen des Klimagases Methan ab. Forscher an der Universität Oxford fanden heraus, dass manche Aquakulturen jetzt mehr Methan ausgasen als die Rindfleischproduktion. Liv Holmefjord ist Leiterin des norwegischen Fischdirektorats. Wir erfuhren in Norwegen, dass sie nicht nur die Regulierung der Fischzucht des Landes innen hat, sondern auch Anteile an einer von Norwegens größten Fischzuchtfirmen besitzt. Viele Umweltschutzgruppen sehen das als großen Interessenkonflikt. Holmefjord hat einen Termin mit Taryn, um Fragen zum Zustand norwegischer Fischzuchten zu beantworten.
Well, fish farming is quite a new industry in Norway. It started back in the 1960s with some local entrepreneurs starting with hobby, and it's grown until it's a billion euro industry today. And seafood is the second largest export industry in Norway, and fish farming accounts for 2/3 of the export value of seafood.
So recently, we found out that you also have shares in one of the largest fish farm companies in Norway. Do you not feel that that's a conflict of interest?
Of course, there could be a conflict of interest. But this is a fact that's been known since before I got this position, and I've been open about it. I'm not involved in the business from day to day or at any. So it's, and if there's, we have, and I have. Sorry, I have to. Do you have to start over again? So all the decisions that I made will either be for the whole industry, not especially for this fish farm, or it's only an advice to the politicians, and the politicians are setting the limits and the actual regulations. So if there's an actual case handling regarding this company, then I will step aside.
We
when on a few jobs I was working here over the years as a diver, we used to be around the fish farms cleaning the dead, deceased fish from the nets and fixing the nets, etc. after storms. And on occasion, we'd seen some of the boats coming in to clean the lice off them. It's quite a lot of dead fish, you know, diseased or they've died. But it's a lot of pink mush, you know, not healthy look. Having seen what I've seen and worked on the various sites round about where I've been in Scotland, I wouldn't eat farmed salmon. No, I would have. pretty rank.
Salmon is marketed as healthy. It's also marketed in a very devious way, deceptive way, that they think it's a wild product. So it's a fake product, it's a fatty product, it's contaminated, it's marketed as healthy, but it's not. So salmon, if you see salmon, alarm bells should start ringing.
It's pretty grim when you dive down to the bottom of the cages because, you know, we always see the bottom full of dead fish. And it's basically because many of these fish are so diseased, so parasite-ridden and laden with chemicals that they become sick and they live out their sad, short lives basically looking like zombies. You know, you don't see this when you go to the restaurant or the supermarket, but this is basically what a lot of the fish actually look like before it ends up on our plates. So tonight, Don wanted to show us how much of the farmed fish actually dies. Because of the very unnatural and unsanitary ways that they are kept, and they have rows of very large metal containers that they are constantly filling up with the dead fish. And I have to say that the smell as we get closer is actually pretty disgusting.
So this is the sordid side of salmon farming in Scotland. This is the dirty secrets the industry don't want you to see. This is disease-ridden farmed salmon. It's 15 to 20% fat. That's where the contaminants, the cancer-causing contaminants, PCBs, dioxins, and the artificial colorings are. So this is something to be avoided at all costs.
This is the salmon farm just here. We got freedom of information data from the Scottish Environment Protection Agency showing the use of over 50 tons of formaldehyde, not just at this site but other sites across Scotland. Is formaldehyde may cause cancer, suspected of causing genetic defects, toxic if swallowed, may cause respiratory irritation, causes damage to organs, do not breathe.
One of the fish farm workers told us that the workers come down to the farm early in the morning, spraying the chemicals into the fish cages.
So they're obviously spraying something down there in the water. The guy who gave us the tip-off said that toxic chemicals are widely used across Scotland, including formaldehyde and also hydrogen peroxide. And these are supposed to treat the diseases and lice problems which are both rampant across the fish farms. You know, these are not chemicals that you want in your body. Whatever he's spraying must be pretty powerful if he needs to wear full protective chemical suit and a face mask.
Das Meer wird zur Kläranlage für 7 Milliarden Menschen. Zuchtanlagen ernähren ihren Fisch mit Chemiefutter und Fisch zu essen war noch nie so giftig.
You know, our oceans have become humanity's sewers. Everything eventually flows into the sea. So if you had a, you know, time machine that could go back before the Industrial Revolution, it's a different story. But now, the highest levels of many of these persistent organic pollutants, we're talking about, you know, DDT and PCBs and dioxins, the highest levels in our food supply are found in the aquatic food chain. Fish are not the safest choice anymore.
So, Tony, it's great to see you.
Great to see you as well. Thanks for coming.
Not at all. Thank you. A pleasure being here. So I wanted to ask you if you could share with us what exactly it was you began to feel when you realized something was going wrong.
I was exhausted more than usual, and then I was losing short-term memory, and that scared the hell out of me. And then I tore my rotator cuffs in a really intense snowboarding accident. And the doctor said, do you want to do your metals test? And I said, I got my amalgams out 25 years ago. He goes, there's so many metals in the environment, you should do it. So I did. I get a phone call a week later, and I said to my assistant, just have him send the report. And he said, no, it's an emergency. He has to speak to you. And it's like, no one wants to hear that. And so I called him up, and he said, Tony, I showed your blood tests. You have extreme mercury poisoning. On a 0 to 5 scale, which is what we measure, 5 being toxic, you're 123. The doctor said, how long has this man been in the hospital? And I just got off stage. So I said, I can't understand this. So I went out, and they thought, you know, maybe someone's trying to poison me because the number was so high. And I was very disciplined. I was a vegan for 12 years, and then I just went salad fish. And they brought the medical group out here, and they looked at it, and I found this man named Dr. Shade, who's the only guy who has an ideation process where you can see where the mercury came from, and it was fish. Uh-huh. It's been 3 years, and I had some severe moments. It burned a hole in my esophagus, and I literally collapsed. I lost a third of my blood supply. I could have died. I lost half my hemoglobin.
People begin to lose their hair,
yes.
Their memory. They lose their memories, as you were doing, as you noticed. But they can also have headaches. They can complain of fatigue. They can also have depression. What we're seeing now is with the toxic environmental exposure, and especially with the mercury, methyl mercury in fish, is that everyone has got to be careful because the levels are going up.
Udo, tell me, because your specialty is in this, how do you get the fish oils that we all need for the brain and for the body if we can't have fish? What do you suggest?
Well, we used to get them from fish oils.
Yes.
But we can actually get them from vegetables. Flax is the richest source of omega-3 that everybody thinks should come from fish oil. If you get enough of that as starting material, your body will make what the fish oils make and it'll be clean.
Many people take fish oils or have fish for the long chain omega-3 fatty acids. And you have to ask yourself the question, well, where do the fish get them from? And it turns out they get them from the algae in the ocean. They get them from plant food. So if you want the purest form of the long chain ready-made omega-3 fatty acids, the best way of doing that is simply to take an algae supplement, because then you've got the purest form of it and you don't have the extra risks of having the toxins and the heavy metals and the saturated fat and the cholesterol that you would get from eating a fish.
Eine peer-reviewed geprüfte Studie von Scripps Institut für Meeresforschung an der UC San Diego unternahm eine der weltweit größten Untersuchungen zu Fischgiften. Die Wissenschaftler fanden toxische Kontaminanten in Fisch aus allen Meeren des Planeten.
Nobody would go to the nearest body of water and put in like a cup and drink the water. You're basically getting the concentrated toxins if we're eating fish.
Unsere Meere sind auch voll von Plastik. Aufgrund der Größe der Meere ist es für Wissenschaftler schwierig, genau zu verstehen, wo der Ursprung des Plastikmülls liegt. Der große pazifische Müllteppich bedeckt eine Fläche von 1,6 Millionen Quadratkilometern und könnte eine Chance bieten, das wachsende Problem von Mikroplastik im Meer besser zu verstehen. Ein Wissenschaftlerteam der Organisation Ocean Cleanup studiert den Teppich schon länger und war überrascht, als man entdeckte, dass der Hauptanteil des Plastiks dort nicht von alten Strohhalmen oder benutzten Wasserflaschen stammt, sondern von tausenden Tonnen entsorgter Fischereiausrüstung, die das Meer in Billionenteile von Mikroplastik zerrieben hatte. Eine kürzlich in der Zeitschrift Nature veröffentlichte Studie fand heraus, dass etwa 80% des Plastiks im Pazifik aus entsorgter Fischereiausrüstung besteht. Viele Wissenschaftler sind sich einig, dass der Wechsel weg von Fisch hin zu pflanzlicher Ernährung eines der wichtigsten Dinge ist, die wir als Menschen tun können, um das Plastikmeerproblem zu lösen.
At least half of the plastic in the sea today comes from discarded or lost fishing gear. Because all those nets, all those lines, all that stuff, it's just become a plasticized ocean. But we have a chance. We have a chance right now to change our eating habits.
There's an estimate that there's over 5 trillion tons of plastic currently floating in the ocean. It's absolutely everywhere. Everywhere we look, we found microplastics, whether it's at the polar regions, in remote islands. Also, if we're looking on the surface or the seabed, and everywhere in between, we find microplastics. We've also found microplastics in just about every animal group that we've looked in. We've been sampling for microplastics for quite a while now, and we found that there's 27 times more bits of plastic than there are fish larvae.
Mikroplankton findet man überall im Meer. Es ist ein Filterfresser. Wenn Forscher Mikroplastik in die Umgebung des Planktons geben, beobachten sie wiederholt, dass es das Plastik zu sich nimmt. Trotzdem die winzigen Partikel chemische Gifte enthalten, konsumiert das Plankton sie dennoch. Die Forscher beobachten, wie die Chemikalien sich in den Organen dieser kleinen Meereswesen anhäufen. Das giftige Plankton wird dann von größeren Fischen gefressen. Und Forscher konnten bestätigen, dass vielerlei Fisch, den wir heute essen, diese Chemikalien in seinem Fleisch angereichert hat. Eine Studie der Universität Plymouth fand heraus, dass über ein Drittel der getesteten Fische Mikroplastik enthielt. Neue Forschung konnte bestätigen, dass das Essen von kontaminiertem Fisch zu Giftanreicherungen in Menschen führt.
Our scientists tell us we're now in the 6th extinction event of life on this Earth. It doesn't even make the headlines. No one even knows about it. We've had 5 mass extinction events on this planet in 450 million years. Let me be clear on this. The last time we had an extinction event of this magnitude was 65 million years ago.
It's incredibly sad to realize just how many species, both in the oceans and on land, that we're losing at the moment. And It's up to all of us to make sure that this doesn't happen in the future.
Today, over 26,000 species are currently threatened with extinction, and the most important driver of that is our use of land for agriculture.
Over time, livestock have been a major driver of biodiversity loss.
Some have predicted that by 2045, the species loss will be so great that we won't recover. The Earth will suffer ecological collapse. And the biggest thing you and I can do is change our diet.
Manche Wissenschaftler nennen diese Krise bereits biologische Auslöschung. Laut dem Journal Science of the Total Environment der Florida International University ist Viehzucht der Hauptgrund für Biodiversitätsverlust. Eine Studie im Journal Science hat gezeigt, dass bei einer weltweiten Umstellung der Ernährung auf pflanzliche Produkte nur noch ein Viertel der heutigen Anbauflächen benötigt wird. Viele der Wälder, die der Viehzucht zum Opfer fielen, könnten daher wieder aufgeforstet werden. Viele großartige Initiativen weltweit tun heute genau das. Ecosia, eine Suchmaschine ähnlich wie Google, ist eine solche Initiative, die Werbeeinkünfte dazu nutzt, lokale Gemeinden für das Pflanzen von Bäumen zu bezahlen. Einer von Ecosias Hauptförstern ist Maurizio, der hart daran arbeitet, die Regenwälder Brasiliens aufzuforsten.
Plantei minha primeira árvore, tinha 5 anos de idade. Eu nem imaginava que 20 anos depois esse esforço tão pequeno teria virado uma das iniciativas que mais plantou árvores na história do Brasil. Foram mais de 2,5 milhões de árvores, 2,000 hectares plantados, muitas áreas preservadas pela ação de combate a incêndios florestais.
Bäume atmen das Leben in unserer Welt. Wenn wir einen Baum pflanzen, sehen wir die Samen für unsere Zukunft auf diesem Planeten. Dr. Markus Springmann von der Universität Oxford in England hatte eine international beachtete Studie zu den Auswirkungen unserer Ernährung auf die Umwelt publiziert. Seine Untersuchungen zeigen, dass die reichen Länder ihren Fleischkonsum um ca. 80% reduzieren müssen, um die Erderwärmung unter der 2-Grad-Grenze zu halten, wie es das Pariser Klimaabkommen vorgibt.
Policymakers have been very, very reluctant to address the livestock issue. It's entirely out of keeping with the urgency of the crisis that we're facing.
Hi, Otto Brockway for Brockstar Films. This is a question for Commissioner Hogan. The scientists at Oxford University have been very clear that livestock farming has a far greater impact than plant-based farming. With this in mind, would it not be common sense to reduce the billions in subsidy payments to livestock farming in Europe and offer them to plant-based farming instead as an incentive to a much more sustainable food system?
We have made our proposals based on protecting the farmers because they are, unlike you and I, they're out in all sorts of weathers and in all sorts of market risks. And you and I may not know anything about that because this is their lives. This is their producing high quality food for us all so that we can have this particular good quality products available to us at all times. Sometimes under local conditions like organic, more times as conventional farming. So we provide financial support at the moment for that. And it's a public good that's not always recognized. But the movement of our policy is in the direction of our farmers being centrally involved in providing more public goods. And if you want to do anything in life, you have to pay people. Sometimes I understand that there's a moral obligation and there's people of principle. But most of the time, 99% of the time, they have to get paid. So as professionals that we're expecting to provide good quality food and do more on public goods, we pay our farmers. This is a decision that we make at political level.
Livestock emit methane and nitrous oxide. Now, most people, when they think of climate change, they think of CO2, carbon dioxide, which is a very potent global warming gas. But methane is 25 times more potent per molecule when it's released than CO2. And nitrous oxide is 298 times more potent per molecule than CO2. These are very powerful global warming gases.
So today we have a very special camera called a hyperspectral imaging camera. And it basically enables us to be able to see gases that would be otherwise invisible to the naked eye. And today we're looking at methane gas. Methane is a gas that is being produced by cows when they belch.
Methan, zusammen mit anderen Gasen, die es in der Atmosphäre produziert, hat seit 1750 ein Drittel der globalen Erwärmung verursacht. Viehproduktion ist die größte Methanquelle, die wir steuern können. Eine drastische Reduzierung der Methanemission könnte die Erderwärmung verlangsamen und ist das effektivste Mittel, um die Erwärmung in den kritischen Jahren zu bremsen.
Whoa, look at that.
Die diversen Erwärmungspotenziale der Klimagase zeigt ein Experiment, das Infrarot-Absorptionsexperiment. Hier sehen wir vier erdförmige Eisskulpturen, jede in einer eigenen, luftdichten Kammer. Die Kammern repräsentieren die Atmosphäre, die den Planeten umgibt. Über jeder Kammer ist ein Infrarot-Heizgerät mit identischer Temperatur installiert und jede Kammer wird mit einem anderen Gas gefüllt. Die erste wird mit normaler Luft gefüllt. Die zweite Kammer ist mit Kohlendioxid gefüllt, einem bekannten Klimagas. Die dritte Kammer ist mit Methan gefüllt, einem Gas, das aus der Tierzucht resultiert. Und die vierte Kammer ist mit Stickstoffoxid gefüllt, ebenso einem mit der Tierhaltung assoziierten Gas. Mit der Zeit sehen wir, wie die Eisskulptur in der Kohlendioxidkammer langsam schmilzt, im Gegensatz zur Kammer mit normaler Luft. Aber in derselben kurzen Zeit schmelzen die Skulpturen in der Methankammer und Stickstoffoxidkammer viel schneller, da die Temperaturen innen viel höher sind als in den Kammern mit normaler Luft und Kohlendioxid. 16 Stunden später sind die Ergebnisse deutlich. Es wird offensichtlich, dass Methan und Stickstoffoxid, die beiden Hauptnebenprodukte der Tierindustrie, potente klimaerwärmende Gase sind. Fast 90% der 70 Milliarden Tiere, die jährlich für den menschlichen Verzehr gezüchtet werden, sind Hühner. Unser steigender Hühnerkonsum wird zu einem immer größeren Problem. Obwohl Hühner weniger Umweltwirkung haben als rotes Fleisch, werden heute 90% aller Hühner weltweit in Intensivhaltung gezüchtet. Und das hat vernichtende Auswirkungen auf unseren Planeten. Wenn wir den äquivalenten Eiweißkaloriengehalt von Fleisch und pflanzlichen Produkten wie Kichererbsen etwa vergleichen, schadet Hühnerfleisch der Umwelt wesentlich weniger als rotes Fleisch. Trotz alledem hat Hühnerfleisch eine 40-fach negativere Klimaauswirkung pro Proteinkalorie als Kichererbsen und verbraucht in seiner Herstellung 50 Mal so viel Wasser.
We know that if we would shift from ruminant meats to other meats, then we probably would reduce our footprint just from that particular product by about a factor of 10, which is quite a bit. But if you compare that with how much you would reduce your footprint if you went to plant-based products, that is about a factor of 100. And that's the reason why shifting towards more plant-based diets has such a big impact, because we're really talking about different scales here.
Biofleisch ist angeblich weniger umwelt- und klimaschädlich. Aber eine Studie von Forschern an der Universität Oxford fand heraus, dass Biofleisch und konventionell produziertes Fleisch kaum Unterschiede bei Treibhausemissionen aufzeigen.
So in our data we didn't find big differences between organic and conventional across multiple indicators. What we did find is that no matter how you produce animal products, even the lowest impact forms of production still create higher emissions and use more land than typical vegetable proteins. So that's saying something really important. That's saying that even if you go into the shops and try and purchase sustainable meat or dairy, it's always going to be better to purchase vegetable proteins instead.
Jedes Jahr gibt die US-Regierung etwa 20 Millionen aus, um Obst- und Gemüseanbau zu subventionieren. Die US-Fleisch- und Milcherzeuger andererseits bekommen mit 38 Millionen fast das Doppelte. Krankheiten, die auf Fleisch- und Milchproduktekonsum zurückzuführen sind, kosten die US-Steuerzahler geschätzte 314 Milliarden Dollar.
When you cram, tens of thousands of animals in these cramped, filthy, unhygienic conditions, basically live atop their feces, it's just like a breeding ground. Animal to human diseases that arise because of the way we're now treating animals, whether it's these live animal markets in East Asia, whether it's the bushmeat trade. And the concern is that with enough spins at genetic roulette on these swine factory farms, these chicken factory farms, we're gonna, end up with one of these viruses that's not only deadly to chickens, but can jump and transmit human to human and cause the next human pandemic.
The risk of large-scale factory farmings increases the risk that we, or the likelihood that we might have a pandemic, particularly of influenza in the future.
This pandemic has been very severe, but this is not necessarily the big one.
Die Schweinegrippe, die über eine halbe Million Menschen tötete, sollen Schweinezüchtern entstanden sein. AIDS und das Ebola-Virus sollen durch den Verzehr von Wildtieren entstanden sein. Mehr ist vermutlich durch Kamele und den Verzehr von Kamelmilch und Fleisch. SARS soll in Lebendtiermärkten entsprungen sein, genau wie die aktuelle Covid-19-Pandemie. Die Vogelgrippe soll ihren Ursprung sowohl in Hühnerfarmen als auch in Lebendtiermärkten haben. Es wird vermutet, dass Masernviren ursprünglich von Kühen stammen.
People know now what a global pandemic feels like. They've seen the effects. They will be feeling the effects for many years to come. And this is a chance, I think, an opportunity to point out that this particular route of infection is a very concerning one.
Die Weltgesundheitsorganisation hat verkündet, dass die postantibiotische Ära naht. Eine Zeit, in der ein einfacher Kratzer am Arm tödlich sein könnte. Unsere lebensrettenden Antibiotika werden durch ihren massiven Einsatz an Milliarden Zuchttieren für uns Menschen nutzlos gemacht.
For 6 years, one thing I know is that if people knew what happened in the production of their food, they wouldn't eat meat. So one of the things that we would hit every day was pus nodules, tumors, cysts. It was something that we would hit on a daily basis. Having worked in a supermarket chain, I saw this firsthand every single day. So here's one that's running along the shoulder blade. Oh.
Yeah.
That is what I remember in the butchery. It comes out like a thick toothpaste. I remember that every single day.
That's interesting to hear you had that experience all the way over there, because in the UK, exactly the same.
Yeah.
We would see that on a daily basis. But those people who say it's not my butcher does this, they need to open their eyes, because if their butcher's being honest with them, we know.
Yeah.
We both know. Honest butcher's going to admit it. They're not going to want to tell the public because it's going to affect their business. Yeah. But it is a fact.
And me working in multiple butcheries, I saw these common trends across the board. So I know that it wasn't just isolated to the one that I was working in. It was across the board for me.
People need to reconnect with what they're eating, and the whole process that we're talking about here of how that food gets to them is hidden from them, and it's hidden for a reason. Because if they saw it, it would most definitely make them want to think harder about what they're eating.
Unsere Meere und Atmosphäre erwärmen sich, und der Wasserkreislauf des Planeten beginnt sich zu ändern.
Climate change changes the water cycles of the planet. The heat that's being generated is forcing the precipitation into the clouds, so we're getting more concentrated precipitation in our clouds and more dramatic, extreme, and unpredictable water events all over the world.
In der nördlichen Region der entlegenen Pazifikinsel Taiwan lebt das Atayal-Volk hoch in den Bergen. Taiwan ist extremes Wetter nicht fremd, aber in den letzten Jahren haben Stärke und Intensität der Taifune zugenommen. Das hat einen vernichtenden Effekt auf das Atayal-Volk und seine Lebensweise. Während ein großer Teil der Welt zunehmend extreme Überflutungen erlebt, passiert an vielen Orten das Gegenteil. Ein großer Teil der Welt leidet immer mehr an extremen Dürren. Tausende Tonnen Ernten werden durch die Trockenheit vernichtet, während Millionen Bauern darum kämpfen, Wasser für ihre Felder zu finden.
I'm definitely worried about the future of our farm. I think we're seeing, you know, many more swings in climate than we've seen in the past. But we want to use all the land that we have to grow food, but we haven't been able to just because of the shortages of water. It'll have an impact on food supply and prices and availability. And so estimates now are between 500,000 to over a million acres of farmland that'll come out of production in California.
Almeria in Südspanien baut 31.000 Hektar Treibhausgemüse an. Es produziert damit die Hälfte des Frischobst und Gemüse Europas, ein bedeutender Teil der europäischen Nahrungsmittelversorgung. Doch Spanien hat seit 20 Jahren mit Dürren zu kämpfen. Klimaexperten vermuten, dass sie durch den Klimawandel verursacht werden.
In terms of water, the truth is that the drought in Spain has become a complete catastrophe. Our harvests are decreasing in massive quantities. Last year, in the area we are now, there was almost no harvest. People don't realize the food system is collapsing.
Als Konsequenz dieses Klimawandels häufen sich auch die Dürren in Afrika. Flüsse und Seen, die hunderte Millionen Menschen mit frischem Wasser versorgen, beginnen zu vertrocknen. Die schwindenden Ressourcen lösen neue lokale Konflikte aus, die zu Massenmigrationen gen Norden führen. Diese Klimaflüchtlinge sind bereit, alles zu riskieren, um sich und ihre Familien an die sicheren Küsten Europas zu bringen. Als Reaktion auf diese moderne Massenmigration hat Spanien eine riesige Mauer errichtet, die an der südlichsten Grenze in Melilla verläuft. Tausende Flüchtlinge schwärmen an der Grenzzäune und überfordern die spanische Polizei. Prognosen sagen, dass diese Migration nur noch stärker wird. Und es scheint deutlich zu werden, dass unsere Welt damit nicht klarkommt.
Osbal, Andrel, Osquigerbet, Mochelpurn.
Mm-hmm.
die mongolische Wüste Gobi immer weiter wie ein alles verzehrendes Ungeheuer ins Land frisst, sind mittlerweile viele der Seen, die die Menschen und Wildtiere am Leben erhalten, am Austrocknen. Wenn die Seen weiter verschwinden, werden die Menschen aus ihrem Zuhause vertrieben und wandern in ferne und fremde Länder aus.
Lustigschüne Zeichen beißen zack. Zeichen sagtri. Hochschule. Angad ich in Nigel Oro so deine Agatskitsch. Mongolschot weigert ich die Tassen zu Jem Dirsaris. Gichte weigert das Chung Arel, Dindu, auch zum Hobsichuan Tagic. In die Hidir Emursichut hintold. Ich hielt die Pchirte, hat Ojelta wachrichte was Hunde.
People talk about how much fresh water we use for hydrofracking. 700 billion gallons globally is wasted on fracking. So 700 billion gallons. Sounds like a lot. But animal agriculture, the production of animals that we use for meat around the globe, uses 70 trillion gallons of fresh water a year. Hundreds of thousands of times as much as fracking. And we give the cows and the chickens the good stuff, right? They don't get the Flint, Michigan, lead-tainted condoms floating in it water. They get the top-shelf stuff because we don't want to screw up our sausage links. And I know what some of you are thinking right now. You're thinking, oh, here's the part. I'm a vegetarian and pigs are people too, meh. But no, let's ignore how the animals are treated in our factory torture farming. Let's pretend they're treated amazing. For just a minute, it's like a celebrity backstage at the Oscars. They're just being fawned over and they get swag bags with free Apple Watches. Point is, you should still be upset about this because animal agriculture is killing us. And corporate media is fantastically pathetic on this topic. They never mention meat production. They never mention that a quarter pounder takes 660 gallons of fresh water to create. That's the equivalent of showering for 2 months.
So one usually underestimated impact of livestock production is the huge amounts of fresh water required for that production to be maintained and to be increased.
The problem is that in many places, water is being used much faster than the natural renewal rates. Overall, in the world, 1.8 billion people are living in areas with severe water scarcity. The livestock sector is the single biggest water user in the world. One third of the water use in the world is being used for producing animal products, meat and dairy. And it's not because those animals drink so much, it's really because there's a lot of water required to make the feed for the animals.
If we want enough fresh water for future generations, water alone dictates that we must change our diet away from meat and dairy.
Überall auf der Welt sehen wir hoffnungsmachende Tendenzen hin zu tierfreier Ernährung. Im Jahr 2021 unterschrieben 580.000 Menschen die britische Kampagne Veganuary. Und es wird geschätzt, dass sich mittlerweile mehr als 4 Millionen Menschen in Großbritannien als Veganer bezeichnen. In Kanada sind geschätzt 10% der Bevölkerung jetzt entweder Veganer oder Vegetarier. In den USA haben 50% aller Küchenchefs vegane Rezepte auf die Speisekarte gesetzt. Das ist insgesamt ein 600-prozentiger Anstieg im veganen Lifestyle nur in den letzten 3 Jahren.
A few years ago, it was quite a challenge to get hold of good vegan food, but today we're pretty much spoilt for choice and there are vegan options everywhere.
Thanks. It tastes like a normal hot dog. Is it a normal hot dog? Like, as in, like, or is this, like, plant-based or something?
It is actually plant-based, yeah. So everything.
It's really nice. I prefer it, because I don't really eat meat that much, so this is good.
Okay. I like meat and it tastes good.
Yeah.
For not being meat.
Would you be happy with that?
Yeah, I'd be stoked. I love meat too much. So I feel like if I went plant-based, I'd miss it. But if this like stuff tastes the same,
yeah,
I'd be very happy with this.
Nice and messy fingers.
It is, yeah. Thank you.
Would it interest you to know that that's completely plant-based?
And I wouldn't know. So that I would definitely,
wow,
that's a winner.
Yeah, I'm amazed.
If burgers always tasted like that, would you be happy to just not eat a beef burger
again?
Yeah,
no, I've got a good way to do it, yeah.
Yeah? I'd like you to tell me which one of these nuggets is plant-based and which one is real meat.
Okay. It's very hard to say which one is.
They taste exactly the same, honestly.
These are not the chicken.
No.
That's interesting.
Which one of this is animal meat, and which one of this is plant-based? Meat or not meat? You're not sure. You're not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Meat.
You?
Yes.
Are wrong. Okay. Okay. But you think the second one was chicken?
Yeah.
The second one was actually plant-based.
No way.
Yeah, and the first one was chicken.
No way.
Yeah.
Okay, I couldn't have guessed that. I definitely thought the first one. Yeah, definitely.
It seems that changing what we eat to a more sustainable diet can also coincidentally be very beneficial to our health. There is a growing understanding that we can actually prevent, and in many cases even reverse, some of our most common diseases all through a shift towards a whole food vegan diet.
Humans can survive on many different kinds of diet, but many decades of research has now shown us that the best way of not just surviving but truly thriving is on a whole food plant-based diet.
A human can be healthy on a plant-based diet without any animal products. The major dietetic associations around the world, including the British Dietetic Association, have produced statements to say exactly that, that a diet made up of whole plant foods is healthy for humans all stages of their lives.
And not only can they be healthy, but they can restore or reclaim their health adopting a plant-based diet.
There are certain areas, certain populations around the world that have extraordinary health and longevity. For example, the largest number of centenarians, people that live over 100, these so-called blue zones.
What's really interesting about the blue zones, they actually have more centenarians than anywhere else in the world. And a centenarian is someone that lives at least 100 years. But what's really interesting about the blue zones is when people reach these advanced ages, they are still productive. So the blue zones have taught us a lot. And the bottom line is we really want to try to emulate what the people of the blue zones are doing.
Die fünf Regionen bekannt als the blue zones sind Okinawa in Japan, Sardinien in Italien, Ikaria in Griechenland, Nicoya in Costa Rica, und Loma Linda in Kalifornien.
So the question is, well, what do they all have in common?
They have a predominantly plant-based diet. They have a diet rich in fruits and vegetables, whole grains, beans, soy, lentils, chickpeas. They have a diet rich in all these nutrients, and that's one thing that they have in common.
So the EPIC study is the European Prospective Investigation into Cancer and Nutrition. It followed over 500,000 individuals from 10 European countries for more than 15 years. Those in the EPIC study that were eating predominantly plant-based or eating high levels of fruits and vegetables lived longer, had lower incidence of cancer and heart disease. About 2,500 of the individuals in the EPIC Oxford only ate plant food, so they were vegan. And even though they weren't the most healthy vegans or healthy plant eaters, you could show that these plant eaters were healthier. They had a lower incidence of heart disease, diabetes, and cancer.
From everything we have discovered on this journey, it seems that moving away from animal foods to plant-based foods instead can not only give us a whole host of amazing health benefits, but also gives us a chance to be able to leave a sustainable planet for future generations to come. Perhaps the single most meaningful change that we can make as individuals is ultimately deciding what ends up each day on our plates.
We are running out of time. The world community must acknowledge that animal agriculture is the most destructive industry on our planet. We can't wait for government policies and other organizations to create a better life for ourselves. We need to stand up now and make our voices heard.
Globally, for the typical consumer, avoiding meat and dairy is probably the single biggest way to reduce your impact on Earth.
Without addressing what we eat, we simply won't make it.
This is a number one priority. This is a next step in taking responsibility for our communities, our planet, our biosphere, our fellow species.
People say, what can I do as an individual? It feels overwhelming. Well, you can make individual choices. We all can. Our individual choices affect the collective choices. When you hear about airplanes and cars, and we're still going to use those things. But the choices we make in our diet, this agricultural business where we use animals as the primary source of protein, the one thing I think we can all do as individuals is make our own individual choices, how we're going to live, how we're going to eat. Plant-based diet makes all the difference in the world. Just make some choices that are good for you, and being good for you will be good for the planet.
Dieser Planet ist unser Zuhause. Es liegt an uns, was jetzt geschieht. Die Geschichte zeigt, dass wir Großes erreichen können, wenn wir zusammen handeln und vereint für eine gemeinsame Sache einstehen. Vor uns liegt die Gelegenheit, eine Welt zu bauen, in der wir gedeihen können. Aber die Uhr tickt. Und die Zeit wird knapp.